Greetings and salutations to all you folks out there. I've got a quick cast for you today, and I'm actually going to kind of buzz this one. It's been a long time since I've done a speed run, but I'm going to introduce the teams, get it up to plus two speed, and watch this one out. This is between zero and 1500 rankings, and it is one of the trolliest games I have ever seen in my entire life, and I'm pretty much guaranteed to miss at least one ACU death. So bear with me. I am trying to get this video done amidst a bunch that I'm doing because I'm going to be gone most of the week. So let's roll on with this without any further ado. On the north side, we have Witty C. He is going Aeon. Then we've got Stoneager. Yes, he is going Aeon. No caps as Cybern and Lachstock. He is going Aeon as well. So triple Aeon on the north team. Not actually the best thing on a spammy map like this one, unless all three of them decide to Harbinger Rush. Then we've got Alphmass and Bitterball on the south team. They're taking Cybern and Seraphim, and then we've got UEF and Cybern for Dr. Schniz and Mason 3. So that is a fairly well-balanced team, missing the Aeon, but they've got a lot of factions to pick from. Moving across the middle, we do have a Hunter. He's going to look for an Expansioneer, try to brighten his day with an early Engineer kill, and that is a hell of a power grid to lay down there, but probably a, I drew a complete blank. Templates, that's the word I'm looking for. Probably a template. We've got Happy Gareth building an edge land factory there, or trying to at least. He's gonna have to be reissued because that was just a little bit too far away for that thing to catch. The Hunter is looping around the back, completely missed any of those engineers, and he is going to run all the way clear around the backside edge. And there it is, reissued there. On this side, it would be nice to see Red picking up the same land factory up there, because yes, it's only two mass extractors, but this is actually a fairly strategic location as this map moves forward in the game, because you can build TML, you can build T3 mobile artillery up there, you can do a lot of things that can kind of control this area of the map. If one team gets both sides and puts area denial tools up there, it makes it very difficult for the other team to advance unless it's through the center channel. Looks like Witty Tail is moving up on the left-hand edge. No upgrades on that commander, and I don't think there's any upgrades planned for anybody else either. Stone Ager sitting, no cap sitting. See what everyone's doing on the south side. Bitterball also laying down T1 power generators using his ACU for build power. Still relatively early in the game, so I mean, unless it was a doozy of a gun rush, probably not going to see anything at this point. Couple of people building air. Looks like Stone Ager is kind of on his own on the north team, and we do have one air factory, two air factories going down on the south side. So a couple of different people dipping a toe into air. On Badlands, there isn't an air player. So basically everybody covers their own bases, and then at some point you need to decide, hey, one person or another should probably go T3 air, and then you figure it out between yourselves who that is going to be. Over on this side, we do have an edge build attempt from Alphmas, but I don't think that is going to succeed. Already got three tanks online for Lachstock, and I think that's going to be the end of that endeavor to claim the Mesa. In the middle, looks like we do have a little bit of an advantage towards Stone Ager. Stone Ager definitely not playing like a zero rank, probably a second account from somebody else, or maybe a transition player from Steam, who really knows. He does have half a mind, though. He does know what he is about. T1 Bomber looping around on the north side. That son of a gun's already got six kills on it, and it is looping around for more. Two veterans. See, nice little jab on the left side is going to get stopped by that ACU. That was a bunch of kills, a dozen or so, I think, on that one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 plus 6 is 14. That is definitely a mass-efficient bomber if ever there was one. And this is the disadvantage on Aeon because, boom, there it goes again. Any T1 bomber colliding with those units is going to be a one-hit kill on every single T1 unit that the Aeon possesses. And then you've got the commander with the gun upgrade, one-shot plinking those tanks, along with a couple of sturdier tanks from Mason, a couple of Mantis getting up in there. So Mantis hordes very quickly shrink Aurora hordes just because of the discrepancy in health. Another bomber passing up and another eight kills for that one. Hey, if you're going to suicide bombers in for eight kills on every one, then I don't think there is any issue there in value whatsoever. Dr. Schmitz laying in damage on Witty Seal. Witty Seal not upgraded. Dr. Snitch, again, does have that gun upgrade. And this is one of those times where you've got to pay attention to how your health is dropping. Pay attention to whether or not he has that large protrusion on his right arm. Because if you don't realize the UAF commander has the gun upgrade, that same rate of fire can sneak up on you in a bad, bad way. Five kills on that bomber. Picking up another group there. Three kills is going to get shot down by an interceptor with a total of eight. I think every single bomber that Bitterball has spit out has gotten at least six kills. That's holy crap. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I don't think that was 20 kills. I really don't think that was 20 kills. It was 12, though. That was a lot of mass in one bomb that just went poof out the window. Dr. Sniz yelling, get TMD, and that is an appropriate conclusion to come to at any point in a Badlands game, because once somebody goes T2, it is only a matter of time until there are missile launchers. And Stone Ager, let's see, he's getting T2 on his commander. A little bit of a kerfuffle in the middle, but I don't think that's going to come to anything. And we do have radar over on this side. Not much else going on. Mostly people getting upgrades and people getting a little bit of extra spam online. I don't see any snipe attempts yet. I see one jester, but that's not really anything to be worried about. What the crap? These guys didn't even see it. What? Was that a disconnect? I think that was a disconnect. That was definitely a disconnect, because there was nothing there that could have possibly killed him. Yup. Okay, we're going to chalk that one up to disconnect and roll on with the game. Unfortunate when that happens to a player, but it looks like Stone Ager is definitely up to the task of securing that base. Dr. Sniss yelling, get up front, Mason, we got to take the base now. Well, I think you've already missed your opportunity for denial, because Stone Ager is moving all of his units out of mid to the left. Nice little response from No Caps. He is covering his open area here that was left by all of those units moving, and Red does have enough spam on his own, unless all of these T1 bombers keep coming across. Here we go again. He is still clumping them up, and they're still dying. If it happens once, why do you keep letting it happen? You need to get all of your units back and get some anti-air up. Maybe some interceptors would be a good idea, because those T1 bombers are literally killing you. Jester moving across the back side. Interesting to see if that comes to anything. And there is an Oblivion turret up that will help slightly versus the gun commander, but only one Oblivion is not going to be enough to stop it. Those T1 bombers still hitting the right-hand side. Bitterball, again, just throwing them away at his opponent, but it doesn't matter because they're killing so many tanks per pass that it is a success every single time. T2 Engineer is still building up an Oblivion. Medusa stunning the one that is already built. That is highly unfortunate. There it goes. That is going to be a gaping hole in security on the left. Yet another bomber hitting over there. Lackstock biting into that reclaim. Definitely something that you need to pick up if you have any hope of rolling back out with some shiny new tanks. And yet another T1 bomber kamikazing against the radar that is worthy of the mass. And then that is going to be moving out to the right. Now this is interesting. We've got a bunch of TAC launchers going down. Hopefully he can get an ACU or something useful with that. That is going to be a very, very expensive build for sure. Blackstock on a pretty decent amount of HP, but he does not have any upgrades. So that is probably not something that I would be leaving way out in front for a potential snipe. Here comes the TML launches. Looks like he's going for the T2 mass extractors. Definitely a good thing to go for. A TAC missile costs slightly less than a T2 mech does. So as long as you're killing at least one T2 mechs with each missile, it is definitely worth the TAC launchers. And sometimes, it can be worth it just to build the launcher and then reclaim it. Because your opponents will see the launcher, build a buttload of mass worth of TMD, and then you can just reclaim it and you never actually spend any mass. It's actually kind of glorious. Looks like more bombers moving out. That's going to be a split attack on those T1 units. Another swath disappearing like nobody's business. Ilshaba's finally going down. They were able to kite a fairly good amount of damage there in the middle, but eventually they do go down after all four Ilshavas. It's only four Ilshavas, and when you have that many Obsidians and Rhinos in the mix, they will not hold up forever. Here comes Bitterball, biting into a little bit of that reclaim in the middle, snatching himself a piece of the pie, and the final TML going down there in the corner. Hopefully he'll be able to kill some good stuff, because that is going to be a tremendous waste of mass if he doesn't. He's got to work on something. Bitterball moving around a fair bit. He's building a point defense there. If he stands still for too long, it would be worth Red's while to launch at him. Do they know that there's that many TMLs up there? They see two of them. They should theoretically know that that is a whole bank of TML. And if they didn't before, now that the bases have rapidly disappearing eco, hopefully they know now. Is that artillery fire? It is not artillery fire. It sure looked like artillery fire. Oh, look! A TAC launcher. T2 PGen going down, Butterball apparently not making enough power to sustain all of that build. And another T1 bomber thrown away to snag about 6 kills on those T1. This is probably one of the most efficient uses of T1 bombers I've ever seen in any game. And here comes more TAC missiles. I can't help but think those would have been better directed right at Bitterball. But Bitterball is going to lose some eco, I think. EMD not doing too well against the Serpentine missiles. 2 TACs launched. Laxtoc's in an upgrade. No! There he goes. Red is dead to the TAC launchers. Magic! Oh, UTML and ITML. Well, there we go. Looks like he did reclaim one of the TAC launchers. Like I said, you can reclaim stuff after it's outlived its usefulness and your mass ahead again. I like the stealth base over here. That is not going to hold up forever, though, because it has been scouted, and there are Evensongs stacking up to lay in some fire against it. The bad thing about Evensongs is that they have such a slow rate of fire, you've got to stack them up together in order to break the bases. T1 tanks moving around the backside edge. Dr. Schniz got some around, was able to successfully run by because there's not enough units on this side to defend. Some damage coming in from those T1 bombers. Did not get any kills directly, but definitely softened up the shielding on those Obsidians. So should they come into contact with any other units, it might be a good deal. There's a strap bomber. Looks like Stone Ager has gone for the T3 air suite. He is pushing out. We've got ASF, we've got a scout. Strap bomber is down in the south, hitting some T2 mexes and moving around. The south team, if they're gonna have any chance at this, they have got to get something down on Stone Ager's base. It is 2v4, but that is a major advantage because we have T3 land for no caps and T3 air for Stone Ager. But Stone Ager is about to have a massive T2 problem in his base. Pillars, not especially threatening if there's only one, but once there's a massive group like this, it takes a lot of overcharges to kill something of that size. Stone Ager stepping forward, not overcharging though. He's got Oblivion Turrets working for him. He is down to 11,000 health. There is a Monkey Lord online. It is getting so close. No Caps is gonna get this. They were not able to kill off all the build power and get back in there. But if Stone Ager dies here, which it looks like he is, did he forget to build? He forgot to build energy storage. No. Don't. Oh, that sucks. And No Caps is gonna lose all of his interceptors in there as well. Good lord. Bitterball falling back as quickly as he can. Hopefully he doesn't get caught up with this Monkey Lord. These guys should be able, well, I don't know. We've got T3 land up. That just lends sniper bots. It's going to be hard to get away when you only have a couple of sniper bots at your disposal. T1 bombers would work well. T2 bombers would work well. Mercies, but there's no Aeon. They're just not going to be able to stop this. No Caps came right down to the edge of this game, making that Monkey Lord, and he got it out just in time. This could be a problem, though. Another group of pillars moving in. There are trebuchets softening them up, and they're taking a lot of damage. Let's see if No Caps actually has Ooh, Bitterball playing Ring Around the Rosie with that Monkey Lord, and it looks like he is going to lose that game. No overcharge for no caps either. Bitterball is down. No caps does not have enough defenses in his base, but there's four loyalists, and I think that may just save it. He is cranking away on that T3 land factory. I think three loyalists is going to be enough to deny all of those pillars, especially if he gets that brick out. The brick will clench it, and oh my goodness, so much veterancy. Why are you building a Monkey Lord? You don't build a Monkey Lord to counter a vetted Monkey Lord. It simply will not work. Would have been way better off building some other sort of counter. We're down to Dr. Sniz, Mason, and Alphmas, and I don't think any one of them has the ability to actually win this. No Cap's base is still shrinking, but he's got three loyalists and a brick at his beck and call, along with a trebuchet for a little bit of long distance damage. And this Monkey Lord is basically just running a lap around the map, and it is wrecking everything in sight. Mason, deciding that it's a good idea to run away, he is going to flee the premises and probably not make it especially far. There's a T2 transport that could get him away. One thing that might work is if they drop all three ACUs on no caps. There's only a handful of T3 units there. They can overcharge what's in the base, and that is a T2, not a T3 commander. So the three ACUs together could outbuild it, could outdamage it, and push come to shove, you could just walk up close to him, damage him till he's 7,500 health, and then control K all three of your ACUs for a draw. But I think it is far, far too late for that. Mason is about to get hit, and he's still running. Why is Monkey Lord? There we go. Trying to land an overcharge. He will land one, but it's not going to be anything of great effect. White, still sitting in the back there, mobilizing some Medusas, but that is definitely not something that's any good. Here comes the best last hope of the South team. A group of pillars moving in, Dr. Sniz with it, and he is landing a good overcharge on that brick. He should have pulled his pillars back and pushed his ACU up front. Now that he's got all of these T3 units here, he is not going to be able to kill those. All the pillars are gone. That is GG. If that would have been micro differently, it might have ended differently. But at this point, Dr. Sniz is taking too much damage from too many units. Kaboom goes, well, nope, he vetted. Prove me wrong, at least for 4 seconds. And then there he goes. T2 gunships coming in for the snipe. That's not going to work because there is flak. So no go there. Ah, and he died. So that is also a no go. And now it's just down to Medusas. Can Medusas trump a Monkey Lord? Not unless you have way more of them than that. And here comes the monkey. Down it goes. And it's vetted. A lot of vet. There is a commander left. He is building an air factory in the back, getting out a couple of scouts. What do you have planned, good sir? What could you possibly do in the face of this onslaught? He has a single T3 gunship out, which is now getting shot down by an ASF. And there's the control K. GG. Carry OP. Monkey Lord OP. Lack of scouting OP. I think that's what we're really talking about here, because holy cow, that was down to the wire. I think that if that had been scouted out sooner, Bitterball definitely would have been able to stop that. But he didn't scout. No one did. And it was simply too late. An excellent, excellent play all the way around. I love trolley games like that. Alrighty, folks, that's going to wrap it up for me on this game. As always, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys in the next one.